For this week, what I was thinking to do was spend today kind of doing a little bit more Wackinator stuff for those who are interested in doing interactive things. I have a few examples I didn't get to really show last week, and maybe we can improv a little bit, and this will help the idea session that we'll have later this afternoon. And then just as a plan for the week, tomorrow we'll get into deep learning and we'll talk about applications of convolutional neural networks. Nothing will be too surprising. We've already sort of talked about it, but we'll maybe do deep dream and style transfer and transfer learning and some other things that we can do with CoVNets in more detail and clarify some points of confusion. And then I have a virtual terminal instance that we can all use to create style transfers. And I can show you the process of doing that. So that will be the practical for tomorrow. You'll all be able to do style transfers. And so, yeah, just getting into more practical things. Today, I want to show you some of the modules that I have that can work with really easily with Wackinator. And then tomorrow, CoVNets and style transfer. And then on Wednesday, we'll get into recurrent neural networks. And again, I have another code base in the virtualized terminal that we can all use really easily that will help us do text generation. So this is another one of the things that have been kind of like popularly used a lot since the beginning of last year. And then Thursday, I guess, we'll have Memo here and we'll kind of keep things a little bit more open. We might do some more fun things on Thursday. And then, looking forward to next week, we'll just get more and more practical. And I'll have like maybe two or three like small bits of lectures that will be kind of on interesting topics that may or may not interest you. But most of the like things that we'll kind of be looking at, the later we get into next week and later this week will be practical materials that'll help you kind of prepare for the exhibition. And again, like we'll by the end of this week for sure, we'll all have like a few tools that will let us pretty easily create something at least simple for the show. And so, that's just to try to alleviate some of the anxiety. Like when I had my ITP class, and that was 7 weeks, most of the
How often did you guys meet a week?
once
For how long?
for 7 weeks.
No, for how many hours in one day?
Oh, like three hours.
3 hours, 7 weeks, 21 hours.
And also keep in mind all those students had a whole course load of other classes. But we did have a lot longer, and people already had a little bit more, like they had more consistent sort of, they had mostly the same background, let's say, compared to this class, because they had the same
That's
education.
why we're cooler. Oh, but anyway,
Yeah, no, it's true, I
continue.
agree. No, I'm just kidding. I love my ITP class. So anyway, the thing is, a lot of ideas were just germinating, in the last week. And so you can really think like we have a very wide variety of things that we can do, and it may just be kind of like a seed for something to do later. And you don't necessarily have to feel like you have to have a really completed project, because a lot of maybe, like we'll see how we structure the exhibition, but maybe the exhibition will be kind of like a little less showy than the last one, and more like, we can kind of present stuff and have more discussion. Maybe we'll have presentations or something. That could be another way of structuring it, so we can, because yeah, it's hard to like make installations right now with this stuff. A lot of it is like a little bit less, a little much more raw than, like computer vision installations have a sort of like a pipeline that's established by now. And here, there's a lot more uncertainty, and so I feel like those are all things that all of us have to deal with. And so we can kind of think about a more bottom-up structure to organizing the exhibition. But in any case, I'm gonna hopefully give you a grab bag of things that you can kind of put together in various ways, and hopefully that will get us into a more practical territory. And yeah, to that end, I wanted to show a few modules for Wackinator. And actually, they're not just modules for Wackinator, they're just like feature extractors that can be used in other contexts as well. So I'll show you some different ways of inputs and outputs, and clarify maybe like the big picture of what we've been looking at. Does that sound like a good schedule kind of for this week? Mate, yeah?
And firstly, the Wackinator stuff, I wouldn't mind if you quickly show up.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, it'll be again, like we'll kind of like, I'll show some modules basically. I don't really have that many slides for today, but okay. Webinar, you guys have seen. So again, I just wanted to review this whole big picture thing, and we looked at this slide a while back. What we've seen with neural networks, what we really like, after looking at all the specifics, you can kind of zoom out and think of neural networks as a way of mapping one kind of information to another kind. So, you know, a lot of the information is like feature extractors or characteristics of data or, you know, real-time sensory input, and mapping that into another kind of data which might be useful to drive, you know, installations or something. So parameters for synthesis or generative art or, you know, all the applications that we looked at in last week's Webinator workshop. And we had a few idea sessions. We did last week was really fun when we had we did the groups and everyone presented all these ideas. You can see how, like, there's all these permutations of inputs and outputs that you can think to use. And a lot of them are kind of silly, but they kind of, like, show the idea that, you know, this is a very immutable thing, and neural networks help us create correspondences between two very disparate pieces of information. And then the rest of the week, Tuesday and Wednesday, will be deep learning stuff, which is, in many ways, it's the same thing. But the whole premise of deep learning is that it helps us get features when they're not easily available. So one of the things is, you know, for all the Webinator stuff, we used ordinary shallow, like one or two layered neural networks, and that's because most of the data that we were working with was already very high level. So when you have a Kinect or a Leap Motion or these kinds of devices that give you very valuable, they already give you high level information, positions of fingers, velocity of the hands, and, you know, positions of skeleton joints and so on. And the whole point of deep learning is that sometimes we're dealing with data that isn't so nice, that doesn't have already this, like, very valuable information. It's just pixels, like raw noise, pixels, you know, who knows, stock market prices, audio samples, frequency bins, this kind of stuff. And then deep learning basically takes what we've done with Webinator and just attaches more layers to the bottom to help us get to the point where it's like Webinator. Some kind of contact there? Yeah. So that's kind of the big picture. And so again, just to review, like the whole Webinator helps us do classification and regression. Classification is, let's say you have data points, which are, you know, you can think of them as being distributed in space if you'd like. And then we're forming class labels. We're learning class labels. So let's say that this data set is such that, like, you kind of have a cluster of red in the middle and then a ring of green and a ring of blue. It helps us figure out for new points, like where I'm moving my mouse around. And Rebecca had a few slides that were similar to this, right? So you kind of like are able to learn what the distribution of these classifications looks like so that when we get new points, we can classify them in real time. Or we can do regression in real time, right? So let's say you have this distribution and it's kind of noisy, but it has some sort of underlying pattern to it. We can model it such that we can interpolate new points within it. That's kind of like the big picture. Does everyone feel like good with that by now, at this point? This is just, I guess we'll talk more about CupNuts tomorrow, but I really like to push this sort of volume interpretation. So you have like a volume of data, and at every layer of the neural network, the volume changes shape, but it becomes sort of more valuable. It carries with it higher and higher level information. Information about the content, or the content of what's inside of the data, or, you know, other high level characteristics about it that can become very valuable for a mapping utility like Webinator. Okay, so what I was thinking to do today, and I basically don't have any more slides after this, so just maybe a couple, is to show you a few modules that I have, which will allow us to kind of create permutations around Webinator, at least with some of the things that I've done. And there's really, like, there's no limit to the things that we can come up with, but there's a few that I have which are pre-baked, and ones that I've used also from Webinator. So Connect data, we have like, I think, 5 or 6 Connects, so people can really, you know, we haven't really used it that much, I guess. But Connect is always like really fun thing to do, to track people in a room and to turn the skeleton data into some actionable parameters for something interesting, you know. And for those who want, I have this, and I think I showed it to a few people, but I'll show it maybe just to everyone and do a tutorial on how to use it. I have an application on GitHub, which everyone can download, called Connect OSC, and it's all it is an application that you start, and it tracks a person with a Connect and sends OSC data directly to Wikinator. So you can use as inputs skeleton data. We have the same thing for Leap Motion. I don't think we have as many Leap Motions, so I don't know if we'll... maybe for people who are interested in hand tracking, you know, depending on how many people are actually interested in it, we may or may not do a session on it. I think the problem with Leap is that, yeah, we only have maybe like 1 or 2. So maybe someone, you know, if you're interested in hand tracking, talk to me, because we can maybe like sit down and we won't have enough for everyone to really do it. But we could also potentially order them. Yeah, they're not overly expensive. And then Face Tracker, so Face OSC. This is in the way that Connect OSC just sends OSC data about the skeleton. Face OSC tracks faces, and a lot of you have used it already. During this course, and again, we can hook it up directly to Wikinator. This one is one that was built by Rebecca that does microphone analysis on the signal, and then sends that again. So you can do things that are like you know, driving things with your voice, or maybe with different kind of sound effects and so on. And then this silly thing with the coffee cup and the croissant here is. A way, and I showed you guys this last week, CovNet OSC, again, a module that I made that sends CovNet activations to Wikinator, and you can use it to build custom image classifiers. And we'll talk about convolutional neural networks more tomorrow, but the idea here is that it's kind of along the lines of what we were talking about just now. Like, Wikinator usually deals with high-level information, like as your inputs, you know, skeleton data, face tracker data, you know, like things that are already kind of like small and high level. But if you want to build something that's just, you know, from an image where there is no very high level, smallified, so to speak, data, you can piggyback on top of a CovNet to do what's called transfer learning. And then I'll show you how to use that as well. Jake?
Yeah, like the whole thing of like sending things out with OSC. Is that like just for Wikinator, really? I mean, like these programs, would you ever use a Connect or a Face Tracker
with OSC
for anything else?
Absolutely, yeah. And I hope I didn't give the indication that it was like just made for Wikinator. Wikinator, you know, adopted OSC because OSC is so great in this regard. So OSC, all of these modules can be used without machine learning as well. Like you can, you know, if you need some skeleton data in an application and you don't want to integrate it into the application itself, you can just run this and then have it send data to whatever application that you want to use it. And yeah, OSC is really great for just trading data among different applications, which is really useful because some applications do things better than others, right? And so if you want to, like, for example, if you wanted to do something with Ableton or SuperCollider or some other audio environment, it doesn't really have built-in Connect support, so you can just use a different application and then send the data to those. So OSC is a much more general thing to know about, which is great. And the reason why we've made all these modules is so to make it easy to kind of get started with this stuff. You know, all of these things can be used without coding. That being said, of course, you know, as I mentioned before, like, I can't overstate the value of being able to code, because then you can go into the actual modules, they're all open source, and modify them to suit your purposes. So for example, one limitation of Connect OSC is that it tracks one skeleton, and I just did that by design. But maybe you'll have a specific application where you want 2 skeletons and you need to change it a little bit, so that if you take a little bit of time to dig into the coding, you know, which we did a little bit of last week, and we had that open framework session. then we'll do, you know, it's always, of course, much more helpful. You can get the computer to bend to your will. And that's what really, that's the name of the game, right?
Is there also a way to do stuff with the web?
Yes. So I mentioned this right here. So if these are all pre-built modules, but really the sixth cell here is where things get really fun. And if you feel like you do want to dive in and code something up, we have open frameworks and processing, MaxNSP. Those are all things that I have experience with, and Arduino also. And we haven't talked about Arduino or done it. I don't know if... Oh, that's right, Alice, you do Arduino stuff, so you might be interested in making some sensors, and you can, Open Frameworks reads Arduino really well, and so if you want to create some sensors that are more, you know, responding to the real world around us, that could also be really cool, and I'm sure that would be very unique, I think.
But I want to respond to the real world on the web.
Yeah, so this is also very possible, and actually one of the examples that is bundled with Wekinator is the WebSockets one, and I think you, Meng, worked at that a little bit, right? And who else used WebSockets?
Yeah,
it was Sukanya. Oh, Sukanya, okay. So yeah, there's definitely there's opportunity to do that. A lot of web stuff is not structured very well, so there are APIs, for example, that you could look at. And if you're interested in that, we can talk about it later. But for example, I know there's a weather API that's interesting to use. There's the Instagram API, which I've messed with a little bit. Twitter has an API, so you can track hashtags and turn that into data, and really all sorts. And in here, I don't have too many specifics because I haven't done so much of it myself. But I can tell you you could have a whole other class about this if we wanted to. Yeah. Jan?
You quickly talked about Arduino. I have written open framework sketch that the brain can write all the code for the Arduino and communicate with the Arduino and all the signals from it and then send it all over the receiving.
Excellent. So that's really helpful.
You just have to adapt it slightly to do some stuff and then you can do things like touch sensors and all that.
Yeah.
Really easy.
Okay. So I definitely I can imagine that would be really cool. I'm sure it would be awesome. And yeah, like Jan said, now we also have some pre-baked code that already communicates with the Arduino. So if you have some idea, I know there's lots of cool sensors. There's photo sensitive sensors and microphones and, I don't know, temperature sensors. I don't know what else people have worked with. Exactly, right. You can, right. Measure the pH of a plant, right? I think those are all things that there's exist components to do.
What was WebSockets?
WebSockets lets you communicate with a web server from your local host. That's the generic tool, but what that will let us do is read and write data to the web or with the web. So that's kind of that's built in, so that's built into the web, but we can use WebSockets, and there's things that make use of it. So who knows, stock market data, these are all just a few examples that I included. Andreas works with the eye tracker, and that's something, if you brought one here, that would be super cool to plug in. So maybe do the audio TCD maybe with the eyes? Is that?
Oh, yeah.
That'd be kind of fun.
No, it has the same, it's built more or less like the leap motion, it's a bit longer, and then you place it underneath your screen.
And it drags a unit and I'm moving it, but it's moving your...
Yeah, you need to be in a very specific position relating to that and the screen, but it just tracks your eyes. You, of course, need to look at the screen.
Yeah, that's cool. Where did you get it?
I got it from the company. It's from a Danish company. There are several commercial manufacturers, but this one is, at the time, was the only one that was available for our Mac. It's called the iDrive. Very cheap, $99.
Okay, so let's also now talk about outputs. And there's a few, and I've shown them all briefly, but maybe I was thinking to do some practical demos. And maybe like some of these, what we might do is like, because some people are interested in music and others aren't. So maybe like, I guess like, what we can do is, I might do a number of practical sessions today. And for those who want to, I was thinking a good way to structure this would be like, for people who want to learn how to use Ableton, we can do a practical session for those people, and then other people who aren't so interested in that could just work on other things. We can kind of break it up in that way. And most of the applications that I can kind of like think to do today that we can improvise a little bit, but the ones that I am generally capable of doing on the spot more or less are like visual art and music stuff, which will hopefully capture a lot of you here, or be interesting to a lot of you, but maybe not to everyone. And some of the, like, so the, we'll, I'll show some processing sketches and how to get OSC into processing and tend to control generative art applications. So like you can make generative art with processing, and you can use OSC to control the parameters. So that control the sort of like different, the way that the, you know, if you want to create some cool visuals and control them with something, some data, we'll do a session on that. And then as far as music making tools, there's kind of like, unfortunately, the ones that are easy to do are using sort of like for pay software, but at least the idea might transfer over if you do or do not use Ableton and you use other things. I also have this, I showed Ableton OSC, which I think is maybe not going to be useful because a lot of you, those of you who are interested in Ableton have Max for Live, and Max for Live basically is better than Ableton OSC because it has more privileges with respect to Ableton's controls. I also have another thing called Audio Unit OSC, so another thing that for those of you who make music with computers, you might know about VSTs and audio units. Those can also be controlled programmatically, and I have this, like, for example, I'll just run this. I've made this one is a little bit less developed, but this is kind of like Ableton OSC. It's called Audio Unit OSC. I have to put this online, but this will let us select parameters and map them, and then actually, like, if you can play it with a MIDI device, I just attached it to the computer. So, like, if we want to, like, let's see if we can get some keys. I really like, where is it? Where's my favorite synth? I think it's, is it this one? So it's like, no, not that one. It's maybe, where's the really, oh, we can kind of look through. Oh, this one. Maybe this one. Wait, that sounds horrible. What's going on here?
Is it being routed somewhere else?
Maybe. Yes. Let's try this again. Oh, there we go. Okay. So, like, one of the keys, and let's use... Yeah. Right, so you can play these and then controlling the parameters in real time. If I want to put a bunch of reverb on it. Right, so I can't do this right now because I haven't set up an input, but we can hook up a lot of the parameters for this. So like if you can mess with a lot of these and, you know, if we just, I'll just make a bunch of changes to this and see how it sounds.
What do we need to have installed? Is this a
nothing. No, this is not an Ableton thing. Actually, this is a bad example because Alto is something that you would have to download or buy. But the point, there's a lot of also free audio units, and we can look at that. The idea is to use this tool to control audio units. And maybe for educational purposes, we can temporarily like give people access to these. But this one is actually like this guy makes it, and so he does really amazing audio unit work.
So I think it's possible to use like kind of, I can write you a letter because it's happened before that I wrote people letters for like getting matched for
Oh really?
For like an education version.
Mm-hmm.
Which also, mean, I know, so I know with Max, with the second set of it's possible, but I don't know if
they would. So how many people would be interested in, like, audio unit or Ableton sessions? Nice handful. How many people would be interested in, like, a generative art, like, visual applications? Okay, cool. So it seems like almost like half to two-thirds.
Oh, I said they didn't want to do the music. It's all the same.
Yeah, I mean, but that's okay. And some people have already started working on like kind of deep learning projects. So like Sukanya, we won't do the DC GAN stuff today, but we'll, I think later in the week that'll become, maybe that might be a nice thing for tomorrow or Thursday to at least present about. So yeah. That's kind of important.
Is Max Alive separate from Max?
Yeah.
Alive? So I've got Ableton Live 9 and I've got Max 7. Do I have Max Alive?
I don't know.
No.
I'm not super savvy on the details. I don't use Ableton that much. But I think there's like a separate license for Max for Live. So.
I saw.
It's included. Max
for
Live is included.
Oh, is that right? Is it come with
it?
You
get a 30-day trial. For Ableton, you get everything with it, and Max for Live is included, but it's not Max. So Max is not Max for Live.
But I've got Max as well.
Yeah. So Max for Live is just kind of like the stripped down version.
Yeah, right.
Of Max.
That you can use inside of it.
Do you need Max for Live if you have Max?
Only if you want to communicate with Ableton.
I mean, it doesn't matter because the new Ableton always comes built in with Max for Live. So whatever version of Ableton you need. Just update and then it comes with
Max for Live. Okay, that's good to know. If that's true, then Ableton OSC is basically obsolete already. So, which is great because it's
no, it's not because you can't. I mean, it doesn't take OSC messages.
Sure, but once you have like Max for Live, you can communicate with Max with OSC.
But you can't plug in the Kinect, for example.
Sure you can. Why not? Max. Oh, it doesn't have like. You can't put in externals into Max for Live.
Not that. Oh, you can. But you cannot build your own instruments with it. So you would have to. So you can.
You can't make your own Max for Live patches.
You can do that, but for the Kinect, it takes the OSC messages. You have to actually rebuild the whole thing. I mean, you can download some instruments from Max for Live that connect the Kinect to it. Because
there's like Kinect externals for
you can
Max.
Use a separate program for the Kinect, like the OpenFamous one, and then communicate to Max.
You can do that also, yeah.
Yes, it's just not very accurate, the ones that are pre-baked for the Kinect.
Oh, that could be true. Maybe if they're using like some...
And if you want to use the Wakinator,
Yeah, fair enough.
For Wakinator, you need to go around and
Well, in any case, like the nice thing with Max for Live is that I think it has more privileges to control aspects of Ableton that like OSC lets you control the parameters, but you can't do things like load clips or, you know, trigger things, I think. So that probably, yeah, I don't know. I don't know enough about it to speak at length, but yeah, it's kind of, Max for Live, I think, takes care of a lot of what
I would still use Ableton OSC for rapid prototyping, and then if I really wanted to refine something, then use Max.
Yeah, you could, right. Nice thing with Ableton OSC, like bundled with Wakinator, is that it gives you all the parameters, it loads them, and you can, maybe you can do things a little more rapidly. Fair enough. Yeah, so it's...
If I buy Ableton, I want to start a band, so who could we? Oh, awesome. We're all going to go. It can be like, what's a band called? I was talking about...
Little Man Group.
The Beatles? We'll be the Beatles. We're bigger than the Beatles.
Broken Social
Scene. Oh, yeah. We're like almost as big as them, right? Isn't Broken Social Scene like 100 people?
Yeah, like huge.
I wouldn't say 100.
Yes, I knew you
were
totally.
It's like half
there
of
there
Montreal. What is it about Montreal and like making humongous bands? Like, you know, you guys like Godspeed You Black Emperor, you know that band?
Yeah, I think it's a cultural thing.
Is it
cultural?
Yeah.
It's like out of like anarchy scenes and.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
Do you know
what
this? What is it for? Black Hole Deadlifts?
For what?
Black Hole Deadlifts?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. I think there's also. Do you have one? Is that, oh, cool. Yeah, you could do that. I mean, I know that, like, for example, people have built stuff that plugs right into open frameworks. So then it's just a matter of, like, taking the example and adding OSC to it. And maybe, yeah, that might be a nice thing to make an OSC module out of. I don't have one myself, but, yeah, if you brought one, that could probably be pretty quick. That's a neat one because, for example, one thing you could do with those, you can think it's almost like Leap Motion, right? It's tracking, you can track a pen through a 2D space, and then you can use that like for example, last week with Rebecca, we talked about dynamic time warping, so you can maybe track gestures with the pen, or you can, any way that you can create a feature vector out of it, it could be used for controlling Reckonator. So yeah, that'd be cool. So yeah, you can see that really the power lies in thinking of all these different input and outputs and the different permutations, you know, and someone might, and then this is where it'll be helpful to have these idea sessions because some of you might work a lot with one input and other people might work a lot with one output, and then suddenly the two people get together and have one person's input control one person's output and
yeah.
We'll have magic. Yeah. Huh?
Just.
Oh, was that a weird metaphor?
Your input, my output.
Yeah. Anyhow, that's basically. Oh, okay. And then I just wanted to mention transfer learning. So this is kind of like bridging the gap between today and tomorrow, which is like what's going on here is that I trained an image classifier to recognize to map croissants to red. And coffee cups to blue. So how was I able to do that? Well, I just gave it a bunch of pictures of coffee cups and a bunch of pictures of croissants, and I sent the activations from a CupNet to Reckonator. And so you can build your own image classifiers. They don't have to be just two classes. They can be any number of classes. You could do classification or regression. So like if you can imagine things that like you want to respond I mentioned a few projects from Alt.ai use this. You know, they took a camera, trained it on some class of images, and configured it to drive some installation or some practical product. One person did, telling apart recyclable items from non-recyclable items. Another one detected computer screens to fog your glasses. There's all sorts of things you can do with, and this is actually a general thing, transfer learning, the idea of, and in this context, it means taking a pre-trained convolutional neural network, which has been trained on millions of images, to understand what images are made up of, the stuff of images, you know, like the components of images, and then it just cut off the classifier that it was trained on, which is 1,000 image classes, and replaced it with a custom one. So in this case, coffee cup croissant classifier. But it could be, you know, we showed can I hug that, right? That was a great one. So can I hug that classifier? This will be something that I guess maybe I'll show today or tomorrow, depending on what the interest is, how much time we have, and so on.
Well, so in theory, you just mentioned three different sessions you would do. So one would be the one for audio, maybe Ableton or possibly Next, I don't know. Then
mm-hmm.
The other one would be...
Yeah, and actually what I'll do is I think Kinect and Face Tracker I'll do for everyone because it won't take that long. So it'll be nice for everyone to kind of like just see how those are. And then maybe we could do like an audio group and a generative art group.
So I'm really interested in the Ableton stuff. I finally decided to get it, but I haven't installed it yet because I had some questions about it. So... I might need a little help. I don't know if you're thinking of doing this today, but
mm-hmm,
I might need
mm-hmm.
help getting that going before.
Installing Ableton, or?
Yeah, just because I was going to do the free trial with the large
mm-hmm,
one, but
mm-hmm.
I actually don't have enough room on my hard drive, so I had some questions about like if you have to install every instrument because it's like 50 gigs.
Oh, yeah.
No, you don't.
I don't think you have to, yeah. And I think probably I know less about this than a few others here. So I would, yeah, but I don't, but I could answer that and say, I don't think you have to. It comes with a bunch that are like, you know, already usable.
It's expensive.
If you get the educational pricing, it's okay. And I think
I told you if you get the, technically you could sign up as a school and then you would get a class set of Ableton Porsche. So these are the controllers and Ableton, the whole license for free. If you actually have, you have to apply for these kinds of projects. But they're around the corner, so
yeah.
Technically.
I don't think it's
so you get everything for free.
I think I have Ableton 9 correct.
Yes.
Hey, these are going online. I do not condone illegal piracy. Yeah. Just a disclaimer. Disclaimer. Criminal students, can you believe it? No, I'm just kidding. So how about this? Now I will do a Kinect and a face tracker demo, and both will just do simple things. And then we'll do lunch, and then after that we can kind of do the more specialized groups. Does that make work?
Okay, but so we need like a little bit of a break to go get the Kinect.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, so we'll take a quick break, and we'll bring out that stuff. All right, I'm resuming. So I'm just okay. Yeah, so I just uploaded this. Hopefully it works. So this is a Kinect OSC version. I'm gonna show it to you from Open Frameworks first, and then like for those who just want to download the release, you'll be able to do that. So this is a build of Kinect OSC, which should just work right with the Wackinator, I hope. So let's give it a shot. And it's located here in my GitHub, Gene Kogan, github.com/GeneKogan, Kinect OSC, and there's now two releases here. So if you go to the main repository with, you said Backstage is ready?
Mm-hmm.
If you go, or it was ready, I guess. Anyhow, if you go to, here we go. Not for me, it is. So if you go to this GitHub, you can download it. A few of you already have, but I'm gonna just show you how to use it, and then for those who want to get set up, we can do this offline. Here we go. Okay, so Kinect OSC, and if you go to releases, you'll see there's two versions of this. There's just Kinect OSC, which these are exactly the same. The only difference is that the Wackinator version is set up to send the to the exact address that Wackinator is expecting. So so you can download this one if you intend to use it with Wackinator. I'm gonna just show it from Open Frameworks. This is what the application looks like. And if you get to this point and you can run it, then you have the opportunity to maybe modify some of the source code if you want to put in two skeletons, things like that. Most of those things are relatively straightforward hacks. And so they're very well within reach. And for those who do want to maybe think about doing things with multiple skeletons or maybe getting different kinds of features, this will be a good way of doing this. And actually, I thought of just one other modification I want to make to this, but I'll do it later. That'll make it a little better for machine learning stuff. Okay, so if you build this, this is just an application which tracks the skeleton of one person. So I'll get in front of it. Sometimes the Kinect can be a little flicky. There we go. It's tracking one person. And you can have it send either the real world position or the screen position. So if it's the real world position, it's taking each of the 15 joints that it's tracking, and it's taking its real world 3D position and streaming it over OSC. And so that's three coordinates, X, Y, Z, times 15 joints. So that makes for 45 values. And if you send the screen position, it's just the 2D version of that. So there's no depth. And that's just 30 values. So it depends on kind of what you want to do. One thing is that Kinect OSC just sends the raw data. But really for machine learning, if you want to do something connected to gesture, then the raw position itself is kind of like maybe misleading. You don't want it to be different if you're like in one place within the Kinect's, you know, field of range. And what's more valuable is actually the like some normalized value, like maybe subtract the torso. So that's something that I'll actually add to this. Then it'll be more gestural. But in any case, we can kind of at least do a demo to show how this works. So this is sending the, let's do real world position. And so it should tell us, 45 values, okay? So let's hook this up to Wekinator. I'm going to open Wekinator. And start listening on 6448. Wek inputs, and we'll take 45 numbers, and we'll have just one output. And we'll just do, let's do it one classifier with, let's say, three classes. How about that?
Do we have to download both versions?
No. Just
the simple one or the Wekinator one?
Whichever one. Well, I mean,
okay.
They'll both work. Just download the Wekinator one because it already has a default OSC address to be sending to Wekinator. Actually, you can also just download Kinect OSC and then change on Wekinator's side. They're exactly the same. Basically exactly the same, yeah. Okay, so click Next. And so now, remember, with Wekinator, we want to train. We have three classes available for this one classifier, and we want to attach them to, we want to basically attach them to one of these. And actually, I should probably make a few more changes to this that I just thought of, but I'll do that in a second. Okay, so let's train class one. What I'm thinking to do is to, well, first of all, let's see if... it's expecting 45, right? So, and it appears to be, this is green. You can see it's green, so we know that it's receiving the correct amount of values. So I want to maybe train Wekinator to recognize three different gestures. So maybe if I can get an assistant, maybe you just want to hit start recording when I tell you. So when it's tracking me. Let's train it to do like, that's fine. So let's have it like, we'll train it to recognize three gestures. This is maybe not the best angle for this. How about, okay. So how about like, this will be class one, this will be class two, and this will be class three. How about that? So it seems to be simple. okay, so... Hit, and let's actually, so class one. So hit start recording. Okay, it's collecting some examples and stop. Maybe you stop, okay.
Yeah.
So we collected 100 examples. Now change it to class two. Okay, so wait. So start recording. So we get some more. Stop. And now change it to class three. And start recording. Okay, stop. So now we can hit train. So now it's training classifier, it didn't take too long. So go ahead and run. Okay, so class one, class three, class two. Class one, right? So we can hook this up in various ways. So here, let me take the seat back.
Oh, yeah.
And I'll, and let's do something interesting with it, okay? So like one cool thing we can do is maybe send it to processing. So here I have like I have a bunch of different programs that do various things. So here's like this is just old processing stuff, and I can give this to basically anybody. This does this just does shader stuff. So you might recognize the image here. it's a deformation shader. So maybe we can like use this to select which shader. Some of these are not very good. So let's say like this is class one, class two, class three. How about that? So this right now I'm controlling with the keyboard, but I can easily add some OSC control to change the actual filter that we use. So I'm going to show you how to do that. So like let's say you have some processing sketch that does something cool, and you want to attach Wekinator to it. Here's the procedure that I would use. I would go into the, and you, assuming you already have, this is in processing, so we've used processing a little bit, but if you already have the OSC library set up, you can go to examples, you can go to OSCP5, and I think the OSCP5 message example is pretty good, and basically just rip it out of here. So I'm going to take all of this, import the OSC junk, put that over here, And we're only receiving OSC, so we don't even need this. We don't need this My Remote location, because this would be for sending OSC. But we're only going to be receiving it from Wakanator. So I'm going to remove that, and then we're going to create a new instance of OSCP5, which we'll put into here. And it will receive messages on port 12,000, right, which is what Wakanator is sending on. Wakanator by default is set up to send on 12,000, right? So now what happens is we're going to receive a message in this special listener right here. So I'll put that at the bottom. Put that at the bottom here. And what should happen is like we'll get an address. So that's going to be string address equals this. And let's just at first, like, let's see if we're receiving. I'm going to do a little quick debug. Okay, so this should be receiving OSC. So long as Wakanator is sending any of it. So we should get an OSC message as soon as I, or maybe not.
It's not running, I think. Wakanator.
Sorry?
Wakanator is not running.
Oh, yes. Good point. Yes, okay. So it's receiving now from WEC. You see WEC outputs. It's being printed here. So let's stop that. Good call. And then to get the, so we'll say like, okay, if address dot equals slash WEC slash outputs, then let's grab the class. And that's going to be int my class equals the OSC message dot, it's like get, I always forget this, get float argument. Oh, it's just get 0.float value, I think, something like this. It always, yeah, it receives it as, so let's just see if this works. I might have gotten this wrong. I haven't used it here. I think I got it right. So do you see it there? So it's like 1, 3, 2, 1, You know why it's being not very accurate right now? Because I'm probably in a slightly different position, maybe. So I think actually the better values to send would be like subtracting the joints from the middle of my body, like maybe from the torso or something. So I will add that to the program in just a bit, but the idea is more or less the same.
But isn't, I mean, it's just not, you still have to do something in order for it to change the image.
Yes. So that I'm just doing one step at a time. So let's just say like, okay, if my class equals 1.0, so that's the first class, then we'll set the index of the shader to be, so there's like a few different shaders that are loaded here. So we could do like, I think these are the two, let's say 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. How about that? I think those are the nicest shaders. Right, so else. So if my class is 2, 3, we'll change this. So just, I know I'm going fast, but I'm making like, this is just to demonstrate how you would do this processing. And for those who are interested in hacking this actual program, all of my processing stuff is like, you know, fair game, basically. So I'm going to run this now. Now let's actually also run this. Okay, so now, shader doesn't have a uniform called W. Because actually what I want to do is set shader. How did I do this before? Key pressed. Okay. We also have to do this for this particular program. Okay. why? could not run the sketch. Maybe one of these is no good. Because, I don't know. Okay, so I broke my program. Great. why isn't this working? Index equals 0. All right, how about this? We'll do 0, 1. Okay. What's going on? Oh, you know what it is? This is a weird, like, I think it's a weird threading thing in processing. So I know a hack that'll, I've had this before. So, because like if it's in the middle of the thread or something and then you change the shader, this is all not important. So here, I'm gonna hack it basically. How about we'll make a next index and we'll say that next index equals 0, and then here in draw we'll say if next index is not equal to index, then index equals next index, setup shader index, and then we'll just do this is next index. So then we'll do it in front of the instead of trying to set up the shader in the middle of the key pressed thing, we'll just have it do it in the draw loop, and then that should prevent this crash from happening, I assume. Okay. Yes. Great. So class 1, class 2, 3, right? Yay. This is fun. I'm just going to do this for a nice, like, 15 minutes. Okay. So a simple hack for a processing sketch. And so if you have a bunch of processing things, you can kind of mess with it this way.
That would be great for, like, morning yoga or something.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. Like, and yeah, how cool would it be to make a yoga, like, yoga bot? Yoga program, recognizing yoga poses, that would be really rad. Yeah, totally. That's what's next. Okay, so that's the Kinect OSC example, and I have like some other processing sketches, and maybe like when we do when we kind of break out into more of a, you know, generative art thing, I can share. Like, I have another. We can do, okay, so let's do actually now a regression example using Kinect OSC, and then maybe I'll just show a face tracker example also. So I have this sketch that will, this I recreated this like GIF made by Bees and Bombs, which is a cool Twitter account that makes, or a Tumblr, which makes, you know, like looping generative art. And we can like change all, there's all these parameters that we can change. So for example, this speed parameter, if we made it smaller, so if I made the, it's 0.09, if I made it 0.01, this thing would go 9 times slower, right? So maybe you could do a regression. Now instead of doing classification, we can attach, I won't do the training procedure again because everyone's seen this a bunch of times already, but if we, instead of doing classification, did a regression, we could map the one of these parameters to one of these regression sliders in Weckinator, and you know we can actually get a feel for this by like just using. Sometimes it's nice to just use the mouse. So for example, if we map the mouse and made that, you know, speed to 1.0, and maybe we did the same thing with the radius. So map mouse Y, 0 to height, to like between 5 and, you know, 100. Let's see now what the mouse, see, it has a lot of effect. It's a little crazy. but you can kind of like, so this is a low radius, high speed. Probably there are better ways to do this, but this is a really high radius. Just the idea is like if you have some cool graphics, you can map parameters to it. This isn't maybe the most aesthetically pleasing example, but you get the basic idea.
And stuff
Andreas.
Like this, then the tweak mode is also really cool.
Ah, yeah, exactly. Tweak mode is nice. It helps you, for those who've used processing, that's one of the tools that lets you kind of mess with the parameters once they're already, once the program's already running. So the shaders. Another cool thing is like maybe movie blending. So this is set up to work with the mouse. I just have two videos here. So when my mouse goes to the all the way to the right, we're looking at this, all the way to the left. So you could do like cool, you know, like regression on the blend parameters. So these are all like different visual examples you could do, and maybe later when we do like a maybe break out into like a generative art group or something, we can experiment with different kinds and we can improvise a little bit. Because I don't have a ton of just, you know, I mean, we can kind of like, we can play with ideas more or less. And I think the next thing I can do is maybe just show face OSC, which will work more or less the same way, just with Face Tracker instead of Kinect. So Face OSC, you can download, you can just Google Face OSC, and it's going to be here on where is it? Is this right? Not the first link, actually. This link is broken, I think, because the downloads don't exist anymore. But if you go to OFX Face Tracker, there's an add-on made by Kyle, and Face OSC is just the release. Oh, we have a new release. Oh no, sorry. Go to the go here and then go to the release. So this is the release, and you can see I released this. I made the it sends the raw data, and you can just download it basically, and or you can run it from source if you have OFX Face Tracker. You can just run Face OSC from source, and when you do, it will look like this. Okay, so it's tracking my face, and you can, and this is what you probably want to do is remove this and select raw, and if you have raw selected, it'll send the actual mesh points of the face as data to this address, raw, it should say here on the release page.
How do you run it?
I have Face OSC downloaded.
Oh, so like if you just click on the, just click on it, Face OSC, that app, right? It's the Mac app.
Okay, don't worry about it.
Oh, here,
it's in the table.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
You have to make sure it's selected.
Oh, is it out?
Yeah.
Do you have to build it from up?
No, you can download the release from here. So just download right here, faceosc, that zip. And it's sending to the address slash raw 66XY pairs, so that's 132 points. So let's try this. So I'm going to reopen Wackinator. Let's make a new project in Wackinator. Get rid of this one.
It looks like the pantyhose.
What does the... What? So this should be sending to slash raw. So change this. And it's 132 values. And just make sure, like, this selects right here what to send over OSC. If you have other things selected, then it'll be sending a different amount of values. So just to send the raw values, have only raw selected, and it'll send 132 values to slash raw. So if we start listening, hang on a second. Gotta get rid of, so we'll get rid of this, and make sure all of this is no longer working. Sometimes when we have to maybe restart Wackinator, because the ports are somehow busy. Okay. Wackinator slash raw 6448. Start listening. 132 inputs, let's do a regression. So all continuous, sending to 12,000, WEC outputs, next. Okay, cool. So now if I am running FaceRC, it should be receiving. Is it not receiving FaceRC? What's going on here? Okay, so something's not working. Let me try running FaceRC again. Oh, FaceRC might be sending on a different port. I think I might have to.
And why don't you FaceRC? This shows the computer, and mine shows all the mesh.
Oh, we probably have different versions. If you download the most recent one, but don't worry, that's not a big deal. Hang on a second.
So is it on WEC output slash raw, or is it just slash raw?
I don't remember. Hang on a second. Message. / raw, but then which port is it sending it to? Oh, 8338, yeah, okay, so, all right, so we can make a version of this that just works out of the box Weckinator, but otherwise we'll just change this to be 8338. That's the port that Weckinator is actually, or that's the port that FaceOSC is working on.
Do you know if Carl's updated to work with 1.3?
It'll be fine, and it's the same. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. So it's actually 8338, 132/raw, I think. So let's see. One, go next, and let's... Okay, sending. Okay, now it's receiving. Great. Okay, so let's do like. So let's just to train like, for zero to be some facial gesture. And so like, how about this? Open mouth, close mouth. We'll control the blending. Okay. So when my mouth is closed, we'll have zero. So I'm going to start recording. And when I open my mouth, it'll be one. Okay, we'll train that. It's 132 points in our data, or 187 points with 132 columns. While it's training, let's open up this blending example. And I'm going to do all the OSC stuff again. So throw this all in here. Make a new OSC, and then when this receives a message, I'll just pull it from here. It's going to receive this, and my value, it's a float value, and we'll map that to the blend parameter. So instead of doing it this way with the mouse, we'll just make it equal to my value. Oh, but actually, my value between 0 and 1 will map to 0 to 55. Okay, so it's running, or it's trained. So now I'm going to open this. Okay, and, I don't want that. Let's get the right blend mode. Okay, I think this is correct. And then run Weckinator. This is not receiving, so hang on a second. I'm doing something wrong. This should be receiving. Oh, we never instantiated this. Is that correct?
Yeah.
work out. Sorry? Yeah. Print line blend. Let's see if it is actually receiving. So, is WebKit actually running? Yeah. So this should be sending. This is sending to Webinator. So this is already controlling, right? So when I open my mouth. Right, so that more or less is working. But then is Blend Movie receiving it? Yeah, there we go.
Wow, how can you just open your mouth and then sing?
Oh. This is so fun. See, this is so yeah, you want to be a like interactive VJ or make like some sort of installation.
So what is this, it's a video?
This is some video of a train, I think in Germany actually. And then the other thing is like some GIF that I copied from this Tumblr called Bees and Bombs, which makes cool looping GIFs. So we can put in another movie too, like, you know, it'd be totally different effect with a different movie, right?
The face OSC program you're using, that's the one I
You maybe you have an older one, or maybe that it maybe there's just different. It's not important as long as you have the raw option. It's like based on a different version of Face Tracker that draws different, either the mesh or the outline by default.
But since it's the same algorithm, so because mine, the one I have, doesn't really work that well.
Yeah, no, they're absolutely the same, yeah. Mm-hmm.
This as well, like.
Yeah, I guess you might all, you know what, if you download it, maybe that actually is the, like if I download it, it'll probably be that also, so let me try to download it.
And by the way, as it's a closed application,
mm-hmm.
the one we download,
yeah.
It would be super nice if you, like let's say if you click on a row, that you know it's 132 values going into that port or something like that. Because right now, if, let's say a student doesn't download that.
Yeah, right,
you,
right.
You don't know what OSC it's
sending. Yeah, it just that, yeah, it says that here. So we just have to make like a special version that says that. Yeah, there's always like tons of things that things think like that we have to kind of think about on the fly. Alright, where did it go? So I just downloaded it. Maybe my version, maybe this is also, oops. Oh yeah, there you go. Yeah, it's just different, there's like, I guess the released version, because I put this online maybe a few months ago or something. And so I think it's just, yeah, based on a different version of Face Tracker, but basically it's just a different drawing mode. It's not actually, it doesn't really matter.
It doesn't really work like now this year.
Yeah, it's sort of like, it's tricky with beards. It doesn't like beards.
Yeah.
So.
Better lighting conditions.
Yeah, lighting is also key.
Do you have eye tracker?
I do not have eye tracker, but Andreas is the king of eye tracking here. Okay, so why don't we maybe like, so we've gotten a super deep dive into like using Face Tracker and Kinect, and maybe later we'll talk about some music applications, and yeah, we can see, it seemed like everyone kind of raised their hands for most of the, like, the music and video applications, so maybe we'll end up doing both, but maybe we'll break for lunch now, and then and come back and do some more hacking. So let's look at maybe just, so at this point, I'm sort of improvising, right? So we can all kind of do this together. Improvising is good. Let's look at let's make this a little bigger. Can you guys all see this? Is that too small? let's do a little bit of sound, right? So let's do like a basic classification trigger, right? And so let's just think, are there any cool inputs that we haven't really used yet so much? So we've looked at Face Tracker, we've looked at Kinect. Let's do a mini idea session. Like what's a way you can imagine playing a musical instrument that you can't right now? Yes.
Well, we're not talking about input from the web, like weather or stock market, or could that be a way of playing instruments?
Yes.
Or do you think about real physical interaction with it?
Anything, like any way of playing an instrument. So yeah, weather.
What about sound is input?
About what?
Sound is input.
Oh yeah, that's good. That's good.
So we could do that. Yeah, why not? We could use. So okay, so let's suppose that we'll use the like MFCC tracker, and that will give us. Let's just think about how we would. How about this? We'll train a classifier on the sound, and then we'll use that, and then we'll code up the output. Right. So I'll open Wakinator. And then the example that I'll use. I think I made a audio. Yeah, this one. So this comes with the Wakinator examples. If you look inside the example, like the you should have downloaded this last week, like examples, or maybe yeah, it's examples. Does everyone have examples? The Wakinator like example pack.
Mm-hmm.
One of the inputs is this. Is the audio OFX Maxim MFCC's 13 inputs. So that's using an add-on called OFX Maxim, which does the, which will analyze the microphone input and extract the first 13, what are called MFCCs, mouth frequency capsule coefficients. That's a feature for analysis of audio. Like if we just open this, right, and I start saying things into it, you'll see that the shape of this changes a little bit. So like if I'm like, ooh, you can see the difference, right, between those two.
Is it the same as one?
Yes.
Oh,
that might be slightly different, but it's basically the same thing. Yeah, you could use that.
What's the same? MFCC? Or?
MFCCs.
Oh, okay, that's the same.
Okay, so. So let's train a classifier in this, right? How about we'll start listening on 6448. This is sending 13 bands here. So we'll set this up 13, start listening, and let's just do one classifier. So I'll do, yeah, all classifiers, one of them with three classes. Okay, so like let's do, if I start recording and we'll let this be class one, I'll be like, ooh. Okay, and then I'll do class two, will be E. Or maybe we should do voices, like multiple voices, instead of multiple, yeah, maybe that'll be next. We'll do like, we'll try voices next. Yeah.
Like you sing one voice, but the whole choir will be different.
Yeah, exactly. What did I just do? Ooh and E?
Yeah.
So next is ah, right? Okay. So if we train this, it's running, okay? So now we can run. Ooh, ee, ee. Okay. I sound like a total tool in my. Okay, so we've trained the classifier. Why don't we now, like, we can do something really simple with it, right? I'm going to pull up the example, again, just copying from the OSC example. This is the normal way to do it. So, like, let's make a thing that's this big, and I'll copy the OSC commands. We'll instantiate OSCP5. This is now listening on port 12,000. And we'll receive this message whenever we get something from Wackinator.
Hey, Gene, can we just have a check in and see how many people are following along right now?
How many people are following along? How many people want to follow along?
Yeah.
So how would you like to...
Well, basically, it's just, I mean, like, they open the file and you find the processing file. Like, I think it's just, like, one
faster. Sure. Okay. So the way I did this was I went into the examples. And if you go to the OSCP5 down underneath, if you go all the way to the bottom, you'll see contributed libraries. So if you go to go to Finder and go to where your processing folder is, it should be in documents. So like if you go to your documents folder, mine is actually in my code folder, but unless you change it, your processing folder will be inside documents. And then once you're in there, find libraries. And that'll be where all your processing libraries are. And I thought everyone had OSCP5 because if we had used it.
She was asking about the
working. Are you asking about processing or?
I didn't know. So the first thing that you. So I have this.
So basically, he opened that and then he was just copy pasting some of the into processing.
Open up libraries. Go to your processing folder.
So that's basically what we're doing there. The
processing.
Yeah, it should just be in like file.
Where is that?
Is it in
go to libraries? So you didn't.
Yeah.
Wait, is that really your. How many versions? Do you have all versions of processing?
No, that's.
Didn't we download OSCP5? Is that the only version of processing you have?
Yeah, just.
Okay.
Is yours empty as well?
Sorry?
Is yours empty?
Processing?
Yeah.
Yeah,
it's empty. Yeah.
Basically,
it's mostly.
I don't like that.
So it should be in the processing folder. But if it's completely empty, the library is
I thought we had some libraries, like, haven't we been using processing? Alright, we'll go through the process of downloading those. Maybe, alright, hang on, wait. Maybe, let me make a proposition. Maybe we'll do this in Open Frameworks because there we have. How about we do it in the Open Frameworks?
Yay!
Alright. so script processing.
Yeah, but generally, like, how can I download
OSCP5. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's do this differently. So first of all, you should have this if you downloaded the examples pack. We did this last week, the examples pack for Wackinator. You should have something like MFCC13. Has everyone found this?
Yeah. Outputs.
No, it's in inputs.
Yeah.
So we have the source code.
No, you can just use it as it is. Yeah, I just used it. I opened it.
Oh, inputs and then what? Audio
just
inputs?
Just search for it.
Yeah.
What's the, so
And then ideally you could create something from Rust.
Okay.
And then MCC is the main.
You can open it in Open Frameworks if you want, but you can also just run it.
Oh, my headphones.
Yeah, and then what do I do?
It's called like MFCC, either MFCC feature extractor or MFCC 13. So you should see somewhere MFCCs. Do you have an inputs folder? Did you download the examples?
Yeah, but I don't know where I put
them. Okay, so re-download them? No, it's just the Weaconator is download. It's just an application. Double click it.
So basically, it's like this should work. I just downloaded from.
Yeah, but you'll have to restart processing. And wait a second, where did you put it? In libraries, yeah. Then if you restart processing, it'll be there.
Maybe move that forward.
So basically, I didn't have any library.
Yeah, maybe not.
Okay, actually, so because that's just the open source event.
Yeah, but I'm trying to fix that. Because I think I was having issues with on Google and stuff.
Not much
I like. You're doing
you
what's that?
Now we're doing
Yeah, I think so because we already. We'll just use Open Frameworks, so it'll be a little easier.
Do you know what add-ons do we need to generate it?
To generate what?
No, no, it's already.
It's already generated. There's an application.
Yes.
What's that?
It's in the essential, in the directory called essential, but not in the examples. In the examples, we only have the source file.
Hang on.
Does it work for you?
No, but I mean, I feel like I'm just looking at the wrong thing. I was working for you last week, so maybe I'm just looking at the wrong thing.
But if you just search for it, it's requiring add-ons and don't have to. I think the best thing is if you get the actual executable. You might have it. Did you not download the examples with the executable?
Do you want it to just.
Where did you find that?
Sure, but I think it's following along, so it's probably in here somewhere.
I think I downloaded it in their two versions of the.
Awesome.
And one is called Essentials.
Wait, hang on.
Is it supposed to be an open source file?
Yes.
Yeah, so these ones, they're not displaying the MFCCs. Is that because they don't have FX Max in it? But that shouldn't matter if it's already built, right?
Wait, hang on a second. Where did I get this thing? Oh, okay. That didn't. Yeah, I have it. All right.
So that's what they
go
have
to the
executable, but it's not working still.
This executable?
Yeah.
MFCC's 13 inputs doesn't work.
That's the one that we downloaded just now.
What happens?
Black screen. I'm wondering if that's because it doesn't have FX Max in.
It shouldn't need it because it's just compiled. Can I see?
Coming up as a black. Screen.
I had that problem for a bit, and then I removed my headphones and then the.
I always had a special my computer. Let's go to the power.
Yeah, Alice is doing the same. So it must be Alice in one.
Maybe.
Maybe it's because
Actually, well, let's fix that show.
Should I just put the bin on Slack?
Maybe it just doesn't draw them in that sentence. So let's see.
Yeah, you had it installed.
Video editing.
Yeah, I'm happy that I just.
pick up the newest version of this probably what ends up. Maybe this is why I couldn't install the other file.
Okay, so it is receiving.
Maybe.
So if we...
But I'm installing Torch this way.
I did it this way as well.
See, this installs the
I did it from the Torch website. I didn't do it from the...
No.
I installed it from the website.
How about this? I'm just gonna... I have something...
What's the...
It worked in the Essentials Mac folder. If you maybe just download the whole Essentials...
Try this one. Try this one right here. Audio, you see down here, audio various inputs. Didn't Rebecca show the MFCCs last week, right? Did they not work for people last week?
I didn't use it.
Okay.
For me, it worked last week. It's just, I don't know, I guess I don't understand if we're supposed to be opening something in open frameworks that looks like code, or if it's just
just trying to open this executable. Try this one right here. I'm gonna open this one. Hello. Okay, this one looks great. Okay, here, download this. No. So you see down here in examples. Go to audio or search MFCCs. That'll bring you down here. And then you see the one that says various audio features. Download the executable for your system. Or if you want, you can do it in Max also. Okay, so that's this one. Okay, this one's working great. I think this one should work for everybody. You see, has anyone not found this? Various audio features.
And then I'm going to go right click, next line. So it's
the premise. No, just download them executable.
So
you can also, okay, so here's an option. You can download the executable or you can download the source code. If you download the source code, then maybe you can modify it, but for now we'll just use it as it is. So but I would just download the executable actually because it might take us, we'll have to get add-ons and stuff, so I would just download the executable. Is anyone still looking for it? Michal, have you found it?
Yeah.
Did you download it?
Yeah.
Does it work?
Yeah.
Does everyone have it? Do you see something like...
Yeah.
Everyone's got this, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's use it. Okay. So here, I'll just start over on the Wekinator side. I'm going to get out of Wekinator. I'm going to open a new... I'm going to open a new version of Wekinator. So this is sending a ton of data, 632 inputs. I don't even really think we need to send. I think we just unclick the FFT. This is like too much data. It should just be, these are probably much better. MFCCs, constant Q, peak frequency, spectral centroid. This is great actually. Is fantastic. So unclick FFT, so it says sending 120 inputs total. Right, everyone's got that?
For some reason, mine isn't, it's missing some information, even though it's the same. So, like, it doesn't say anything about inputs,
yeah.
And it also doesn't have the stuff on the side.
Yeah, me too.
Mm-hmm. Oh, that's weird. It looks like it's probably missing a system font or something.
Maybe like...
That's okay, though. It's
maybe
fine.
Maybe Rebecca updated it because I
downloaded it. No. Oh, maybe. I don't know. But that's okay. It should be sending fine. It's just missing a font or something. Okay, so start listening.
Okay.
and do this. Make sure this matches 120 inputs, and it'll be sending to WEC inputs. And let's just do one classifier.
Three classes.
Wait, one classifier or one continuous?
Wait, this is wrong. Why is it receiving? Oh, I have a problem myself, sorry. Make sure you're not running multiple feature extractors. The header. Okay, various audio inputs. Uncheck FFT. Start listening. 120 inputs, one class. Classifier with three classes, let's say. Okay. Has everyone gotten to this? So maybe we should all, since we're all following along, where we can all make our own, we can do this in unison, like oohs and ahs, yeah.
Wait, why did you go back and change the values of the web?
Which one's the, oh, I just restarted the project. I didn't change it. It's
numbers?
I just to make a classifier with.
It means 120 inputs now. So
yeah.
Actually, did you change that? Maybe one. How many
class? Let's say three. I mean, we can do, like, we don't have to do all exactly the same, right? I'm just doing a simple example. All right, so we'll all do a three class. So, okay, I'll restart Wackinator. So start listening on 6448. We'll have one output, and it'll be all classifiers. And then we'll say with three classes. So this is the configuration that we'll use. So it's sending 120 inputs. So let's train the three classes on oohs, ahs, and ees. How's that sound?
Oohs, ahs, and ees?
Yeah, now here's the trick.
Constants spike them. It's already different.
Yeah, those might, yeah, I mean, I don't know if you're spot checking, maybe. They're probably all very good together. Anyhow, the trick is you want to be, you know how when you start recording, it starts recording, and you stop, it stops. So you have to make sure that you hit the start recording after you start making the sound and hit stop recording before you stop making the sound. Not at the same time you don't want silence to get in there. Right? So on the count of three.
We have a fun project idea we could do all together.
What's that?
Like a audio Ouija board where we use like pitch and volume or something to control
mm-hmm.
a cursor on the screen to select.
Or pitch and
oh.
So pitch is the X and the Y could be.
I think that'd be really fun. The only thing is. Like all of us collectively, we'd have to put a microphone somewhere.
Uh-huh.
Do
you think it doesn't pick up the room?
Well, I suppose it does, but it'll be skewed towards, you know, wherever the microphone's facing.
Yeah. Anyway, let's do this.
Yeah.
Look, all right, so on the count of three, we're all gonna do a little ooh. And after we start oohing, hit start recording. And we'll do it for like, we don't need to do it for more than like 3 or 4 seconds. So let's say 3 seconds. I think 3 seconds should be good. And then hit stop recording and then we'll all stop. So this will be an ooh. So let's practice. Ready? Ooh, that sounds great, doesn't it? Okay.
Are we ready?
Yeah. Okay, so output one, we're sending, and we'll go on next. So when I, one, two, three, should it be on the three or then three and
after?
After.
It's
okay.
Ooh.
What's that?
Listen.
Yeah, yeah.
Could we do like 1, 2?
Actually,
three,
we don't even. We should
four.
Just as soon as I start ooing, everyone.
What if you count like 1, 2, 3, 4?
No. Yeah, yeah, okay. All right, ready? All right, so ready? 1, 2, 3. Ooh. Just like that, right?
That's beautiful.
That's beautiful. Let's do an ah. Okay, ready? 1, 2, 3. Ah. All right. 3 will be E, right? 1, 2, 3, E. All right, so let's train that. Now we'll have to. Okay, so now. Okay, how about this? Let me build. All right, we'll let's first test the classifier. Now the thing is, all of our microphones picked up everyone. And so it'll be, and so we have to kind of do this in unison, I think. So let's hit run, and let's try to all ooh and see if it goes one for all of us, right? Ooh, it's pretty good, right?
Yeah.
Did everyone get roughly
yeah.
one?
No.
And like, let's try E. E. How about the ah? Seems pretty good, yeah? What, yours don't work?
Do you have to
repeat the ooh was a little bit, but...
I fucked up on my eye.
I think, like, while we do it all together...
You can try to remove the offending examples if you
yeah.
can find them. So how about now let's do something with that, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So... let's create a new project in Open Frameworks. I'll stop running this for now. So let's go to your project generator. Let's have an idea. Let's see if we can implement an idea we come up with now. Like, cause I was just gonna do something like change the background of the program. But what's something that would be cooler? Like, what can we do with depending on what class we're singing?
For the physics engine, you can have different objects, so one object is a square, the other is a circle, the other is, I think, like, I can't remember, but depending on a U or R, E, it's basically dropping down different, it's raining different objects.
Mm-hmm. We can do that. Let's go around, let's get some more ideas.
What about some possession?
Possession?
Percussion.
Percussion, okay. We can do a sound example.
Oh yeah, we could have a synthetic voice adding stuff on the top of the different letters, right?
Maybe the thing is sound input and sound output is going to get a little muddled, right? So it makes sense to do like a visual, right?
But we need to try Ableton.
Will you do something in Ableton?
Yeah, I put that.
Well, we could send the probability distribution back.
Or we could play a Pac-Man.
What's that?
We could play Snail or Pac-Man.
We can replace what?
We can play like Snail or Pac-Man.
Oh, I see. Well, that might take a long time to code.
Yeah, let's try drums.
Let's try drums in Ableton.
But isn't drums then messing up the...
Yeah, we'll get
feedback.
We'll get some feedback, yeah.
Because it's getting...
Oh, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, it makes sense to drive... it might make sense to do something visual.
Yeah, visual.
Right.
So
okay.
We can just write congrats.
We could, like... we did post glitch the other day, right? We could control which glitch we use, right? We could, the physics thing also makes sense. We could do all of those things. We could do both of them at the same time.
In theory, I guess, if we would do a sound thing, because they're not participating because they didn't want to do sound things, and if we don't do sound things, we do the things they wanted to do,
yeah.
then they're totally not caught up, and it's kind of awkward.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, they're probably not paying attention, so we could probably get away with it, but...
Are we doing some
things? I mean, I'm just saying, like, if we would continue with the sound examples somehow.
Yeah, but that's, I think it will be totally messed up, because once it's playing back sound into the microphone, it will be totally...
Yeah, yeah, it will probably kind of...
We can
yeah.
do it at headphones.
You can put headphones on.
Yeah, it's kind of antisocial, right? It's
well, it's just a try.
This is just a demo, right?
Yeah,
like this
yeah.
is so let's just do something. All right, I'm going to go back to dictator. Democracy failed, so... Alanis, let's do. I kind of like the box to D thing. Maybe that'll be complicated. So let's mess
box
up.
To D is super cool, yeah.
Let's bring both in. I'm going to bring in. So, whatever you want to do, if you're going to do your own, make sure you. Whatever you use, make sure you use. Have OFX OSC.
Mm-hmm.
How many of you are coding along with me? Like, if you want to create an output? So we'll do at least a basic thing, and then like you don't necessarily have to use, because you may not have Box2D. Actually, I kind of don't want to use Box2D because I think it'll be complicated to implement, so I'm going to get rid of Box2D. I'm going to use OFX OSC and OFX Post Glitch. So if you don't have OFX Post Glitch, just Google OFX Post Glitch and then install that in your add-ons. So we have an empty project with OFX Post Glitch and OFX OSC, right? So in the header file, in the .h file, we need to include those libraries. So we go include OFX OSC. And include OFX Post Glitch. Then inside the OFApp class declaration, we'll declare an instance of OFX Post Glitch. So call it like glitch or whatever. So let's see if I can remember how to use OFX Post Glitch without looking at the example. I think I can. We need an FBO. An FBO is the frame buffer object. That's the thing that we'll draw into and then apply the effects in OFX Post Glitch. So that's OF, FBO, and we'll just call it FBO. So let's do this, like FBO.allocate. So in the setup now, we're going to allocate the FBO, which means we're going to give it some memory to draw graphics into. So we go FBO.allocate, and then let's decide what size. Let's just make it the whole size of the screen. So for width, we'll use OF get width, and for height, we'll use OF get height. Now we want to decide, like, should we do this on a movie? I think let's do it on the webcam. So we're gonna create a webcam. So the thing that we're gonna glitch is the webcam, which is always fun, right? So after the OF FBO, let's create an OF video grabber, and we can call it cam. So that's our camera. And then we'll go cam.initGrabber. And the default camera inside of a MacBook is going to be 640 by 480 pixels. Okay, so you should have this in setup.
How do you know these commands?
So it's written in a few places. There's examples. There's like if you go to the Open Frameworks examples, there's a folder inside of Open Frameworks called examples, and then inside of, I forget which folder inside of it, but there's a video grabber example. Or you could use Spotlight and search for video grabber example. That's one place. It's also, there's documentation on the Open Frameworks website. So if you go to the, like, the reference, and there's a few other places. Let's just get the camera on the screen. So we have to, ever on update, we need to update the camera. So we'll do cam.update. And then we'll do cam.draw at 0, 0. So if you do this right and build it, you should see yourself in the app when we run it using your camera. Oops. Yeah, you misspelled it. So you check the errors. Yeah. Does everyone have a webcam running? You're not updating it properly? Go to your code. You're missing the update. Above draw. Okay, so now we'll initiate glitch. And it goes glitch.setup. And then we pass in setup, you see how it's looking, it wants an FBO, or more specifically a pointer to an FBO, which is like a reference to that object in the memory. And the way you give it is @FBO. So this attaches the FBO that we're going to draw onto to glitch. And so glitch.setup @FBO. Ampersand, yeah. Yes, that links glitch to the FBO. So now what we want to do is, instead of drawing cam to the screen, we're going to draw the cam to the FBO. The FBO is like an object containing pixels. The way you would do that is you go FBO.begin, and then you draw the cam, and then you do FBO.end. if you do this and you run it, you'll notice that it no longer shows the camera because we're no longer drawing it to the screen, but we're drawing it into the FBO. So like if I ran this, it would be blank now because the camera is no longer being drawn to the screen, it's being drawn to this FBO. However, we can draw the FBO instead. So I can then just go fbo.draw00, and that will draw the FBO to the screen. So now we're drawing the camera to the FBO and the FBO to the screen. And there's some glitchery here. This is all like, you might see some junk from the... So I can explain that. That's actually... So there's a cool thing about... So what FBOs are is an FBO is a... It's like when you create an FBO, you allocate memory on your graphics card to draw pixels onto. When you allocate memory to the graphics card, it has all these like... The memory of the graphics card has all these other graphical objects on it already. Because it doesn't, you know, automatically clear anything. So when we allocate the FBO, it just grabs some memory. It doesn't reset it. There's no reason for it to. And so what you're looking at right now, besides for this... actually, this would be fun. Just comment out this, and we'll just draw the FBO. Like, this is kind of neat to look at. So when you just draw a recently allocated FBO, you're looking at, like, the most recent memory that was allocated, that your graphics card was looking at. So you might recognize, like, random bits of graphics in your... And this is actually even more fun. Like, if we could do this, we could allocate it every time. Like, let's see what happens if we do this. We'll allocate it and draw. We're getting away from the point, but this is kind of fun, so that we can just see what happens if we allocate the FBO on every frame. I think it may slowly... There's ways that we could, like, cool things you can do. It's actually a neat, like, you could run this through the glitch. There's, like, a lot of, and people do this kind of stuff. This is just, like, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Screenshot,
yeah. But anyway, we're getting away from the point. Let's go back to, let's undo all that stuff. And you should be back at this. Now, to get rid of the glitch, the way you do it is between begin and end, we use OF clear. What that does is it clears all the pixels. So it's just the transparent FBO. Okay, so what we now need to do, I have to remember how glitch works, so let's look at it. And this is just the general, you know, like when you don't know how something works, look at the GitHub page and it says, okay, so you have to allocate an FBO, you have to set up the glitch in the FBO, which we've done. And then what you do is, you go the glitch, whatever you called it. We called it glitch. Here it's my glitch. You run .generateFX. So before we draw it, we'll go glitch.generateFX. Now, if we do this, we still won't see anything because we haven't turned any of the effects on. So let's turn one of them on. So this one, like .setFX. So you would go like, maybe after the setup, you can go glitch.setFX. And then in the first argument is one of the effects types. And what we do is we use, like, it defines all of these constants that refer to the different glitch effects. And you can access them like OFX. Let's see. Yeah, you see they're listed here. If you, in Xcode, it should start to autocomplete. So you can pick one. Like, let's do the convergence one. And then the next argument is, like, we'll enable it, so we'll run true. So if we run this, we should get some glitchery on our camera. Oh, no. Okay, so I did something wrong. What did I do wrong? Hang on. Oh, I think I know. Oh, yeah. Okay, so there's one other thing you have to do. I forgot to do this. Find OFX post glitch in Finder. So if you find OFX post glitch in Finder, there's a folder inside of there called shaders. You have to take this folder and you have to copy it to the data folder of the app you're working on right now. So you go to your app, wherever it is you put it, apps. If you didn't change it, it'll be inside of apps, my apps, and we called it like Wekinator sound example. And you go into the data folder, and you copy it there.
Inside of
bin, data.
What kind of git key do we have?
I don't know. Probably. I think it's probably empty. Yeah. So if we run this, you should now have this. Some glitchery.
Looks like 80s.
Exactly, yeah. It is very 80s.
So
I haven't been able to run any of this because it's in the same main header. Is there
use that library, you have to get the account as well.
Yeah,
It's just set it up because it has a different information about a lot of them that you're using for it. But you get it in the
Can you re-download the frameworks? Just have one version of the web. Okay. So how many people are at this point? Okay, so I'm going to keep going. So there's like multiple effects, right, that we can use. So now let's attach an OSC listener. And when it receives class 1, we'll turn on one effect. When it receives class 2, we'll turn on another effect. And when it receives class 3, we'll turn on another effect. So a simple thing, right? So the way we'll do that is we'll create an OFX OSC receiver. And we'll call it OSC. So did you put the shaders inside of the data folder?
Yeah, in data.
Yeah.
Just like this. Like, it seems like it's running, it said it succeeded, but...
No, it didn't succeed. You have a breakpoint. Like,
it's running in the back.
Okay.
See? Like,
so,
oh, yeah.
Have OFX OSC receiver, and then we're going to set up OSC. To listen on port 12,000, which is what Wekinator's sending to, right? So OSC that set up 12,000, and this is just a general lesson on OSC now.
Yeah.
Like this is just how to receive OSC in open frameworks. When and there's also like what I'm doing. I have it just committed to memory, but you can get this if you look on. If you go to the examples in Open Frameworks, so you go here to Open Frameworks and it goes examples. If you go to communication, not communication, sorry, add-ons, there's an OSC receive example, which is a completed project that shows you how to receive OSC messages. So I'm basically copying from there, but I'll just do it by text because I know how to do it. The way you receive messages is inside of update. You do this while, and so while is another kind of loop. So like, you know, there's for loops and while loops. While loops is like, while something is true, keep doing this. And the condition is while osc.has waiting messages, and it'll autocomplete this for you. So as long as osc has waiting messages, run the following. So get a brace in there. So it's like this. And inside the while loop, you create an OFX OSC message. We can call it MSG. It's typical. And you do osc.getNextMessage. And then you just pass message to it. And now we'll see what, and now we'll be like, okay, we have this message inside of OFX OSC message. And we'll see if the message, if the address is equal to WEC outputs, right? Then we know we have what we're looking for. And we know kind of that the only thing we're sending to it is that, but it's kind of a good habit to, you know, in case you have other OSC messages flying around, it's nice to usually get in the habit of comparing the address. So you'll do msg.getAddress double equals slash WEC slash outputs. Then do the following.
And that folder WEC outputs gets it automatically.
What's that?
Is that a folder? I mean, that address WEC outputs, or is it?
It's not a folder. It's just an address.
It's just an address.
Yeah. The slashes is just like a convention that OSC often uses. Okay, so now if we have that address, we know that it has a class value associated with it, which we can grab from the message. We can go. Float, you know, value or whatever we want to call it, equals msg.get arg as float 0. So that will grab the first argument inside the OSC inside the OSC message. So now we know the value is either 1, 2, or 3. Okay? So we can say if value equals 1.0, do this. And we'll leave that blank for a second. Else if value equals 2.0, do this. Leave that blank. Else if value equals 3.0, do this. So now we have to fill in these blocks.
Does it sound like anything other than this?
Sorry? Because it's a float, actually, I mean, you could, like, so floats are decimal values. If you left it as 1, 2, and 3, it would work also, but it's just kind of for being, for the sake of posterity, I guess.
Does in this example, does what can intercept anything other than 1, 2?
No, because we have only one output. If we had more than one output, which you could set up in the, it'll send as many outputs as you create. So here we created one output, which has three classes, 1, 2, and 3. So it just sends that one number. So here's what I'll do. I'm just gonna cut this, this glitch.setfx. I'm gonna remove it from setup. I cut it so I can paste it here. So here we'll say if 1.0 will set OFX post glitch convergence to be true. Let's use two more effects. So we'll have three effects and we'll turn one on and turn the other two off for each of these. So for 1.0 we'll set these two true to be true, this one to be true. And let's pick two more to be false. So glitch.setfx, and we can pick one of these. It'll start to. So let's try like.
Let's put like wavy ones.
That's swell, I think. Yeah. So let's do swell. And we'll set that to be false. And then let's also set. slit scan, like this, to be false.
Mine doesn't auto generate.
Sometimes it just takes a while. Try pressing escape, and then like, it usually has to sort of cache it. It should auto complete after a bit. Are you seeing it now? Yeah, if you don't, then just copy it from here. It should, sometimes it takes a while. The open frameworks actually, like, this is kind of a bad thing with open frameworks. It doesn't use namespaces, and so when it does autocomplete, it, like, searches through the entire C++ library for autocompletes. Once you have that, just copy it into all of the blocks. So copy this for here and for here. But for the second one, we'll just change around the true. So instead of true, false, false, we'll have in the second one false, true, false, and in the third one false, false, true. So like we're turning one of them on for each of them and the other two off. So like this. Is it working correctly?
Yeah.
All right, so I'm surprised it's working because we all like recorded together, so maybe.
Well, it's just always looping.
Yeah, right, it's always, exactly, yeah. Right, so I'll run this also. So just to remember, all three of these components have to be running. So you have to have this running. And you have to make sure that Weconator is in run mode, like this. So, so basically like that. And you can all control it for me. Also, like when it hears you, it. So who has that running successfully? Oh yeah, let me see.
Train it again. There's a lot of, it's picking up so much
noises,
information.
Where is that? Oh yeah, it is.
Who's having fun?
You can use those balls and money.
Should we keep adding to this example? What else can we do?
Well, no, because, so essentially the thing that we said was, we were going to do a sound example, and then we were going to switch, and then they could pay attention. So I guess just keep the schedule, like what is kind of the
Okay. So let's... I guess it's sort of both, right? Because we have a sound input and a video output. So now we can do maybe a reverse. We can do a video input and a sound output.
Yeah. Could we also do instead of the classifier, it's like the regression thing, like the sliding.
Yeah, we could do that too. Might be good to try to do both.
Wait, but we just need to communicate.
Let me see. Maybe your shader is
a bit...
Let's see the console. Console sound, maybe what header is that running? Computer is running. Do you have the... That's sending. Try it, just that.
Huh.
Oh, Oh, so you have two things running, so like your OSC is probably not finding. Try to just, well, is this working? I think it is.
Thank
you. Yep. Yeah, it probably didn't work so well for my voice because it's trained on yours.
Is it really?
The loudest voices in the room. We're all together.
Okay, let's leave that aside. So for those of you guys in the back, people in the back, we're going to do another example, maybe invert it. So this was a sound making video example. Now we'll do a video changing the sound example. So for those of you who want to rejoin, now is your opportunity. how many people are interested in now doing the opposite? So like we do something with a video input and turn that into sound. All right, cool. Sorry. okay, so now we'll do that. Cool. So let's scheme some idea. How about we have a little brainstorming session? So like, what can we do? Like video turning into sound. Does somebody have an idea? What can we do?
Movie file, like.
Movie file.
Or trailer. Trailer. Different trailer.
What is it possible? Probably not. Like if. The video had a bird in it, then it would play a certain sound.
Mm-hmm.
Is it not enough time to do it?
Say it again, if a video has a bird in it, play a certain sound?
Then it would play. Or you know what I mean? Like if it recognized a bird or recognized something in the video, then...
I think we could do something like that, but... No, I think we could do that, maybe. So, do we have a video that has ample birds in it?
Could we just use the webcam and...
We could use a webcam, yeah.
Yoga poses trigger certain sounds.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, we could do like a transfer learning example, right? Where we train some image classifier.
Could we be just use like a bottle or
something? Use a what?
Like a water bottle or something that I know.
Or
yeah.
The more people that stand in the frame, so you get two people, one person, two person, three person, and
mm-hmm.
it always adds a sound to it? Or is that...
No, you could do well. Yes, but what I'd like to do is show you guys how to do transfer learning with CubNet OSC.
Oh, okay.
So we'll
do
an image classifier. So let's do an image classifier. So let's just say as a general thing here, we'll take the webcam. We'll train it to discriminate between two or three classes of objects, and we'll have it do what?
Play a sound.
Play a sound? So like a simple thing would be to play some sample over and over. But maybe we can come up with something more clever or more sonically interesting.
It just recognizes it if it's present or not, right? Not like where on the screen it's present. Or could
yeah, exactly. What you just said.
Where on the screen?
No, not where on the screen, yeah.
Could it play back like something? Yes, no, or just an audio file that we pre-recorded with instructions, like, don't throw this. Or
yes, absolutely, yeah, we could do it, so like a simple thing would be to trigger a sound.
Yeah.
So maybe we should just do sound triggering.
Trigger.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's do a trigger.
Maybe
it's color information from it and then trigger sound related to that, so we can draw some data from the image we're getting as well.
I didn't catch that. Say that again.
I'm just wondering if we can use the video data that's coming in as well to trigger the output. So if we're doing is recognize the bottle, then it also recognizes that there's a lot of blue in the image, so it will make quite a low sound.
Why would it recognize that there's a lot of blue in the image?
I'm just wondering to make a more interesting output if it recognizes something else.
Well, we're going to get something more abstract. So like the way we're going to do the input is I'm going to show you how to do this transfer learning idea. So let's do that. Everyone should already have OFX CCV, right?
So you want to do a new file or the same?
Yeah, let's make a new file. So go back to your... So I'm going to close this. Close everything, basically. So close your audio example now, and close Wekinator. And now we're going to make a new example in our project generator. We'll call it Wekinator, Wekinator CovNet example, or whatever you want to call it, doesn't matter. So the add-ons will include our OFX OSC and OFX CovNet, OFX CCV. So you should have these. So just, but we will do that. We'll actually include it. So include OFX OSC and include OFX CCD. So make in, so we'll work with OFX CCD first. So you'll create an instance of OFX CCD and we'll call it CCD. Okay, so you have CCV. Let's also make the webcam. So OF video grabber cam. And now we're gonna set up CCV and cam. So we'll do, let's set up the cam first. So cam.setup, or sorry, cam.initgrabber 640. 480. In update, we'll do cam.update. And in draw, we'll do cam.draw. So let's just do a sanity check and make sure we're seeing webcam with these. So run this, compile it. Right? Yeah, cam.initgrabber. Yeah, 640 by 480. If you, that's typical for webcam. So now we'll do setup CCV also. So we'll do CCV.setup. And then this, where it's look, it's a setup string network. So what it wants is a reference to the file that contains the weights of the network. That's that SQLite file. So that's why we included it inside the data folder. So inside of string network, we'll give it the name of that file, which is, I forgot what it is, so I'll just copy it. It's like image-net-2012.sqlite3. You can just copy it from Finder. So it's this. Did you include it?
Oh.
Yep.
Good, thank you.
Mm-hmm. So make sure you've included OFX CCV right here in the header file, declared it inside the OF app, and then set it up inside setup. And then underneath cam.update, do what we want to do is we don't want to update it. We don't want, so now what we're going to do is we're going to analyze every time the webcam image changes. We're going to analyze the we're going to grab the activations, the CoveNet activations, like those pixels, right, the responses from CCV. But we don't want to do it on the same image twice. So sometimes, like when you get the next frame of your app, the webcam may not have changed by then, because the webcam's frame rate is only like I think typically 30, maybe it's 60, but I forgot exactly. But basically, it's probably 30, and OF's frame rate is actually 60. So on the update, sometimes the camera image won't have changed. So what we want to do is we actually want to check first if the camera has a new image, and the way, and then we'll encode it then. So we go if cam dot is frame new. That means camera has a new image for us, which means that we can grab. We want to then pass the camera to CCV so that it analyzes the activations and gives it back to us. And the way we do that is vector float. So vector and then in carrots float, right? We're creating an array of floats. So we'll call it like vector float, let's say activations equals CCV dot encode. And now let's look at the encode function. What encode does is it takes an OF pixels image, OF pixels. OF pixels is a class that refers to any class in Open Frameworks which carries pixels. That includes OF image, and by extension, the camera. Because the camera inherits from pixels, so does OF image, and a few others. So we can actually, even though it says it's looking for OF pixels, Video Grabber is actually what's called a superclass of OF pixels. So it is a type of OF pixels. So we go ccv.encode cam. And then actually, before I do that, I'll just show you. It says it looks pixels and then which layer, right? So we go cam, and then we need a number for the layer. The layer that we want, we can grab any layer in principle, but what we want is the second to last layer, the layer which carries that 4096-bit vector of content activations. And to do that, what we do is there's actually a function inside of CCV, ccv.numlayers, which is the number of layers it has. So ccv.numlayers minus 1. So this will, yeah?
Mm-hmm. Well, so if it was just ccv.numlayers without minus 1, it would pick the last layer.
Yeah, it would give you the 1,000, yeah. Mm-hmm. That's correct. Right, so now we have these activations. And let's do this. Let's actually run this. And what you should, just to make sure it's working, what should happen is that you should, first of all, it should not crash. If it crashes, it might be complaining that it didn't find the file. And your camera should be really slow. So you see how this is now going really slow? It's like once every maybe half second. And that's because it takes a while being a quarter second or whatever to actually do the analysis, so it can't maintain that frame rate anymore. Right? Anyone having problems with that so far?
If you wanted it to run in real time, is there anything
you could join the scientific research effort into making forward passes go at frame rate. We are limited by the laws of physics at this point.
You couldn't cut down on the...
Well, you could in theory use a smaller network, right? But we don't have one. We don't happen to have one. But if you use actually in theory, also using a earlier layer, it should go faster also because that's to propagate through fewer layers. But then the information is less good. Yeah.
Like specific hardware things that you can buy that run
Yes, this does run faster on GPU. There is a little bit of maybe twice as fast.
But I'm just thinking like things that you could plug into your computer. I don't know.
No, you need like a serious GPU.
And a serious GPU that would run on an external server.
On what?
On a server.
You could also do that, but then you have a different kind of latency, which is the network overhead, right? You have to pass the image, and then, so that's not, so yeah, there's, I mean, yeah?
I'm getting an error from FXCCB. It doesn't like how many layers, it's saying it's a cloud access code.
Did you put an uppercase of it?
Probably it didn't load the network.
Yeah, I did the brackets, so it's in a bracket.
Do you have, oh, yeah, yeah, do you have the parentheses, brackets, yeah, these?
It wasn't loading.
So are you sure you have this file, ImageNet 2012, inside of the data folder of that app?
Yeah, it's there. It's just not liking NLayers, ConfNet, pointed to cat.
Are you sure you have it written like this? Oh, the ccv.numlayers minus one, right? And make sure there's parentheses after numlayers. Like these?
Yeah,
let me see.
I have the same issues.
So I'm going to try running. Code is all the same.
Uh-huh.
So I've got numlayers minus one. It takes me to. This isn't an old version of your add on, is it?
No. ImageNet. Let me see this. Where do you have it? Can I see the.
Yeah, just in front of
it. Maybe the dot words thing. Actually, screws up. Let me see. Let me see what happens if I.
Do you think my SQLite could be dodgy?
Let me see.
How big are 90?
Yes, it's 120. That's exactly what's wrong.
Okay.
So it's not loading it properly.
Maybe it didn't download properly.
You might not have finished the download. Yeah.
It's possible. We have it in quite a few places, though. Because we've been using
a
few things.
I would, yeah, exactly.
So
it's going to be in the ImageCC. That'll definitely be there. You could get it from ImageCC.
That one. Okay.
Oh, but you don't have it in there. Oh. Because
that was the other one you made. But what was it called again? It was called
ImageNet 2012.
I'll just find it somewhere else. Okay, that's probably it. Oh, yeah. That's
make sure it's 120 megabytes.
Complex. And that's the one. Okay. They're on 90. That's pretty odd.
Oh, there's one. Grab that. Yeah.
SQLite 3, though. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
There you go. Yep.
I see here that the problem was the SQLite is the wrong file size. So you could possibly just copy and paste it in different ones.
Yeah, same. So the best thing to do is rather than have to download it again, you can just copy and paste it from somewhere else. So if you just search anything, find more features. Well,
sorry? Did it definitely finish downloading your terminal?
I'm sure it's video editing and external GPUs.
Because it seems like it's happening.
By the process.
Yeah, I mean, it's possible. It's just that usually, they don't just plug into a USB. You need like a desktop with a PCI Express port or something.
Yeah. So it's better than running on the server.
Yeah, you could run it on the server.
How do they?
Is it easy to set it up?
To
run it on a server? The GPU?
You could run it on, you know, like an Amazon thing or something, but define easy. I mean, there's a process, like, you know, and you have to set up the. I mean, it's a process. It's not something that you double click on.
But if you're making a delay,
I'm gonna continue, guys.
Yep.
Okay, so if you've done this correctly, guys, stay with me. If you've done this correctly, you should be, it should be going, you know, kind of, you should be getting some slowness in the chem. That means the activations are being grabbed. So now what we're going to do is we're going to send them to Wekinator. Right? So we'll create, so make sure you've included OFX-OSC. So create OFX-OSC sender OSC. And just so everyone knows, what I'm doing right now, I'm basically rebuilding OFX. I'm rebuilding Covnet OSC. This is all Covnet OSC is. It's like there's just a few more lines of code, and then it's done. So so this will at least help you understand how it works. So let's set up the OSC. So OSC.setup. And we'll give it localhost, so that's going to be this computer, or your own computer, and port 6448, so which is what Wekinator set up. And again, like, that's not, that number's not, you know, handed down from the heavens or anything. You can use whatever number you want, you could change it. So that's set up, right? Now, after the activations, we have this new set of activations. We're going to create a rather large OSC message with 4,096 numbers, and we're going to somehow pass it to Wekinator. Let's do that. So OFX OSC message MSG. So you create an OFX OSC message. And then we'll go message.setAddress. And what should the address be that we use? Anybody know? What was that? WEC slash inputs, right? Slash WEC slash inputs. So now we have a message with the address slash WEC slash inputs, and now we're going to add all of these activations into it. So we go, so we create a loop which will go through all of the activations. It's a vector, right? It's an array, so we'll go through each element in the array and add it to the message. So you do for, or we create a loop. For a loop we need for int I equals 0. Semicolon, I is less than activations.size, I plus plus. So this will create a loop that will go through each of the activations and we'll add it to the message. So we do msg.add float arg. And then activations, bracket, as we say in the US, I guess in Britain you guys use brackets for parentheses, right? Well, what do you call one of these things?
Square brackets.
Square brackets, okay. So square bracket, I, right square bracket. Add float arg, right? So you should have basically we just added this.
How do you spell rights?
On your keyboard, I have no clue. I don't even know how to, I don't even know where the Y and Z is located in your European keyboards.
Yeah. No,
mine is
just,
alt.
It's like
alt 7, 8, 5, 6, 7.
Rachel, I still have mad sand in my hair. Alright, so then we'll go. At the end of this, we can now send the message. So we go osc.send message msg. What's that?
What is CC doing?
It is analyzing the webcam image, grabbing the activations, and then sending them over OSC to Reconnator.
And what is the activation?
It's those, remember when we analyze the image with the CubNet, we get all these filters, these responses, it's those. It's the very last one.
CubNets can be a lot of different things.
Can be what?
I mean, those are what are complex, analyze what represents the image or what?
It's the we're passing an image through the CubNet, and then we're getting all these responses. Remember all the in the demo, the responses, the feature detectors, right? It's those. We did this. I put the lectures online for the first week, so we covered them in like the first day, and then I think again on the third day maybe. So we go through this demo, right, and then you see at each layer the response of all the filters being passed along the image, and we get a response, right, and we do a classification. Yeah.
But to recognize the. Pattern shapes.
Exactly, yeah.
Existing object.
That's what it's doing, yeah. Okay, so now let's try to send this to Weconator. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna run this, and it should just start running. Right? Do you have this slow webcam thing going on? So now let's launch Weconator, and we'll start listening on 6448. And then what we're going to be looking for is /WEC/inputs with 4,096 inputs. It is a lot, yeah.
And how could we guess it? It's the number of pixels in the image?
No, it's the number of it's the number of activations in the second to last layer.
Let's say we do it by ourselves. How could we guess this
front? Well, activations that size, so you can print it to the screen. Right, so we can be like, C out number of arguments equals activations that size. This is optional if you want. This will, like, the number, this. activations that size is going to tell you how many there are.
Otherwise, next time we open the button, we just...
Yeah. What's the area you're getting, Alice?
It's... What is
missing? Is it a compile error, like your error in the code?
No, it says...
What's that, sorry? Let me...
Oh, I didn't put the local host. Oh, that's why. Is that wrong?
Yeah, you never set up OSC.
Oh, I didn't see that.
Yep. So slash WEC slash inputs, number of inputs is 4096. And there's one thing that we have to do. So this, because it's such a large feature vector, it may take a really, really long time to train if we have a complex network, like with hidden layers. It might also be better, but one thing we can do to cut down on the amount of time is we can go in, I forgot exactly how to do this, one moment. Oh, we'll do it in options, okay. So actually, let's do this. So in the outputs, we'll have one output. It'll be a classifier with, let's say two classes. Just to start, we can do two classes. And then go to options, choose algorithm, and how do you do this? custom. Let's go to custom, configure. Yes, here we go. So this is a little lesson on how to customize Wackinator's neural network. So we'll leave this the same. Outputs, localhost 12,000, and we'll have a numeric with, using a neural network. Where's the... It was after we set it up. Yeah, you're right. Actually, yeah. Okay, so do all classifiers. Class with one, with two classes. So we'll go next.
Two classes.
One output with two classes, yeah. And then it's here, edit. So when you have this, you can click on this edit icon. And click on this right here. And this is interesting. You can also we're doing a hard classification, but you can grab the probabilities instead. So that's a nice feature to be aware of, which may be kind of nice to use. But actually, it's not here. It's.
We don't need to be using regression to use because the classification.
We could do regression also.
Where did you find this option?
In the edit, but it's not correct. Hang on. My Wackinator is freezing also. Actually, I'm going to stop this program for just a second because it's freezing my computer. And try to recall. We did this last week and I've forgotten how. Model type k nearest neighbors. Maybe an SVM might be smart to use. But. Let me just see.
To edit the type of neural network, you need to have a continuous one. So you need to start a new one, open it up, and then you can just have a new one there. So.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah, right, right. All right, so let's start a new one, yeah.
So a whole new one here.
4,096, yeah. Options. Not from this.
But we're doing a binary.
Where did you find the number of layers?
So yeah, so now you'd say yes, next, and then you can say we moved in before.
One output, two
that's
classes,
yeah,
all classifiers.
So yeah, all continuous.
Oh, they have to be continuous.
Yeah, you have to be continuous. That's where the neural network options are.
All right.
Classifiers don't do neural network.
But do we want to continue myself?
Yes.
The classifiers don't use neural network. Okay, you know what?
Oh my god.
That's probably. It'll probably be fine if we just use a support vector machine.
Yeah.
So let's just use an SVM. That'll probably be faster too. Let's try. All right, we're experimenting now, so let's just see. For 4,096, all classifiers, let's do classifiers with two classes, one output, and let's choose a support vector machine. Yeah, k-nearest neighbor would take forever, so let's do a support vector machine.
But wait till it's all classifiers and now it's continuous. I thought he was just saying, I don't know.
No, because that would use a neural network, but we want to... Well, okay, so let's quickly discuss what the difference is. Remember what the difference is, right? With regression, we have one continuous value, right? With classification, it's trying to predict a class. Although you can get a continuous value because it'll give you a probability of each class, which is actually not exactly, but basically equivalent to having, like, if you do two classes and extract the probability, then they're going to add up to one, right? So it's going to be like, it's like an interpolation between those two classes. So it's like the same as regression, equivalent. It's not trained the same, but it's equivalent. If you have multiple classes, then your probabilities still add up to one, but it's not like a line anymore. So that's a little different than regression. But this will work for us. I also think it'll be faster.
Options? So did you change something? Options?
No. I did. Choose support vector machine. I suspect support vector machine will be the best for this, not k-nearest neighbors. K-nearest neighbors might be okay also, actually, but let's try the SVM. Make sure this 4,096. Click next. And now let's run our CubNet OSC. Okay, so now this should be running slowly again, and you should, of course, have the green OSC in, which means it's grabbing the inputs. So now we're going to train an image classifier. So what do we want it to classify?
Why do we have only two classes?
Whatever is in your pocket.
Sorry?
Why do we choose only two classes?
Just for the sake of simplicity. You can have more classes if you want. So I'll train it to recognize my phone.
I train it to recognize my keys because then it will unlock my computer.
Do you have to train one on yourself and one on yourself?
Yeah, I mean, maybe you can do like, all right, I'm going to do how about a remote control versus phone. So... Okay, so for class one, I'm going to put my phone in front of it and then start recording and kind of like maybe wave it around a little bit. And also because it's going slower, you see the examples are collecting much slower. So you might want to give it, you know, get it up to like 50 or 60 or something and move the phone around. Try to get a nice diversity of positions. So stop recording. Now I'm going to switch to... the remote control and change the class now to class 2 And now I'm gonna do this to the remote control. Start recording. Move it around a bit. Get closer, maybe. Just capturing more examples and stop. Now we'll click train. And it's training and it's done. So this is one nice thing about SVMs is that they're super fast to train, even on large amounts of data. So now we can run, and now it should be, so like remote control is 2, phone is 1. It's pretty good, right?
Yeah.
2,
super active.
1. It's very accurate.
Yeah.
You could do a neither, yeah, that's one way of doing it. Sorry?
For known, when there is nothing.
Yeah, that's one way of doing it. And also, like, we could have done this so that it would give us the probabilities, which may or may not be useful to you. Like, maybe if it's like 55-45, you're not confident about it, and maybe you don't want something to happen. But yeah, this is the basic thing. Okay, so I'm going to stop running this, and I'm going to talk about what we just did. So we're receiving this this classification, and actually one neat thing that we could do to update this right now is that we can have Wekinator then send the results back to the same Open Frameworks application that we have, right? So then this Open Frameworks application will send the activations to Wekinator. Wekinator will make the classification and send that one number, which class it is, back to our Open Frameworks application. So I'm going to implement that now. It's like this. So now we have an OFX OSC sender. I'm going to make another OFX OSC object, except this one's going to be OFX OSC receiver, and give it another name. So it can't be OSC, so let's just call it like OSCR or whatever you want to call it. And then we'll set up OSCR with the port, right? Now the receiver doesn't need to be given a host because it's not sending to any other computer, it's just receiving. It just needs a port. So Wekinator sending on class on port 12,000. So we'll set that up to 12,000. And in update, we can be like, okay, while OSCR dot has waiting messages, OFX OSC message, MSG, if MSG dot get address double equals slash WEC slash outputs. Okay, I'll just go through this whole code statement and I'll leave it up. We'll grab the value from it. And I think Wekinator just sends it as a float, even though we're really it's an integer. It's sent as a float, I think. So it's just a number, yeah. Exactly, yeah. But I think Wekinator sends it as a float, regardless, rather than as an integer. So we would do float, float prediction equals msg.get arg as float 0.
Wait, what's the motivation behind?
Sorry?
What's the motivation behind this receiving? So I understood.
I think just to be consistent, because like often we're usually working with floats. So I might be wrong. It actually might also send it as it might actually be. You might be able to grab it as an integer.
We were just sending images, and now we have to grab the output back.
Yes.
Sorry,
right. So float prediction equals this. So now we can be like, okay, if prediction equals 1.0, and do this. Else, if prediction equals 2.0, do something else, right?
And could we just have an else statement, or is it just better?
It's you know, just for the sake of posterity, it's nice to do. You could just do an else statement because we know there's only going
to
be two options. So you could do that if you want.
The code.
Yeah. So how about, I'm going to do a really simple thing. I'm going to color the background red or blue, depending on which class it is. So what we're, but we don't want to just use OF background because we want to like set the color. What we want to do is actually, I guess this would just work if we just did this. OF background 255.0.0 for this, and OF background 0.0.255 for this.
Could we put an object on top of our? I mean,
what's that say?
Could we draw an object on top of?
You could do anything, yeah. I mean, I'm just doing like a really simple, yeah. Okay, so I'm going to run this. Oh, sorry, I forgot to do something. This won't work yet. So this goes, while OSCR has waiting messages, but we never actually grab the message from OSCR. So we have to be like OSCR.getNextMessage and then add it to message. Yeah, right, we actually never took the message. So actually, if you were to run this, it would freeze inside that while loop. So, okay, so now it's sending. We have to get back to turning, we have to turn Wackinator on to run. So there you go, it's sending blue. If I put my phone in front of it, it sends red. Blue, red, blue, red. So that's the basic thing. I'm gonna leave this code up right now so you guys can grab it. And here's what I want to do because we're at the end of the day. This is an assignment. I want everyone to like take this code and make some sort of a image classifier using the procedure we just showed. I'm going to put this lecture on YouTube like tonight. It'll take a little bit to upload it, obviously. But if you have any questions, please let me know. But I'll put this on online. And for bonus points, I know that we don't have a lot of time for assignments because we're like here tomorrow morning. But for bonus points, make it do something awesome. So. You know, like instead of just changing the color red or blue, maybe you can make it, you know, do something awesome. Like bring about world peace. So class one should be world peace. And class two is going to be like, you know, climate catastrophe. All right? So it's just.
I guess I'll say you don't have to draw the webcam.
You don't have to, yeah. You don't have
to. I
want to
do some nice sketch.
Yeah. You don't have to draw the webcam, yeah. That's just for us to see it.
Uh-huh.
I'll check that in a second. But before I do, let's just see. Are there any questions that you think, like, does anyone have questions that are relevant to everyone?
Where did the 4096
So 4096 is just happens to be the size of the activations of the second to last layer for this particular network. Because of CCV, we always have this one network. We should probably get a new one, but anyway, it happens to be made with 4096 neurons in the second to last. Yep. It's very typical for it to be a power of 2, which 4096 is a power of 2. It's 2 to the 13th power. Because of like the way its GPUs are set up, they like square matrices. Yeah. Does anyone have any questions?
I mean, I want to know how to pull probabilities, but I feel like that's a whole.
That's in. You can do that. And actually, like, if you look on Wekinator's website, there's tutorials that'll show exactly how to do that. Yeah. But you can also just experience, because it says there's an option, and if you change the flag to be give me a probability,
yeah.
Then I think what it does is it sends, I forgot exactly, it probably sends two, it probably just, you have to look at it. It either sends the probability of the first class, or maybe it sends a vector of probabilities for each of the classes.
But I think it changes the output path slightly.
It might do that also. I have to check. I don't remember myself. Okay, so I'm going to stop the recording and then help like for individual problems. Okay, cool. Stop.